Well, good morning. Please open your Bibles to James chapter 1, verse 22. James chapter 1, verse 22. And they tell us pastors that if we want to connect with our congregation, we've got to be vulnerable. Got to be vulnerable. So I'm about to be vulnerable so that I can connect with you. I'm going to tell you something that until this moment you didn't know about me, and that is that I have rogue hairs on my eyebrows. I do. They're not a whole lot of them. There's just three or four. They're thicker than the other hairs. They're darker. They grow faster. They stick out like horns if I don't take care of them. I don't know if anyone else has this problem or not. I never noticed them until my precious wife, Libby, pointed them out to me a little while ago. Encouraged me to, quote unquote, do something about them. So over the years, I've taken care of my rogue eyebrow hairs, and you've never known, have you? I've done a pretty good job, I think. Well, this morning, I got up and I looked in the mirror, and there they were. They just kind of sneak up on me, kind of come out of nowhere, and I got distracted, most likely something else on my face that needed attention, and never took care of my rogue eyebrows, and came to church and started to work, and part of my process early this morning was just trying to figure out how I was going to start this sermon. And so I prayed, Lord, how do you want me to start this sermon? And while I was praying, it popped into my mind that I hadn't taken care of my rogue eyebrow hairs. And so I started to wonder if that's how he wanted me to start the sermon or not. I pushed a pause button on my sermon prep, and I ran into the bathroom with my scissors, and, well, let's just say they won't be bothering us anymore. You see, I looked in the mirror once, and it made no difference. And then I looked in the mirror the second time, and some positive life change occurred. What was the difference? The difference is what theologians call application. Application. I actually did something about what I saw in the mirror the second time, and positive life change occurred. The first time, I didn't do anything, and I may as well not have looked in the mirror at all. Why am I telling you this story about my rogue eyebrow hairs? Because we're going to talk about application today. We're learning how to read the Bible. This is the last sermon in the series. And we've looked at three specific things we need to do when we're reading the Bible. Observation, figure out what the text says. Interpretation, figure out what the text means. And today, application. Let me just say in passing that as far as observation and interpretation go, we have barely scratched the surface. I've felt all the way through this series that I have so much more that I want to tell you. What I left on the editing room floor would fill a whole nother series. And so we have just kind of whetted your appetite. I hope that you will dive deeper into your study of Scripture. But today we're going to focus specifically on application. And it's a very important aspect to Bible reading. And I wanted to take you to James chapter 1, verse 22 and following, because although there are a number of texts in Scripture that point to the application of Scripture, I think this is one of the most pointed and one of the most specific. So let me read it to you and we'll dive into it together. James 1, 22. Do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. Okay, stop for a second. I want to remind you that in the ancient world, most of the people were illiterate. They didn't read the Bible for themselves. And so when you see something in Scripture that says, don't merely listen to the word or hear the word, that's because in that culture, almost everyone heard it with their ears. They didn't read it with their eyes. So they would go to synagogue or they would go to the church gathering and they would sit down and people would open the Scriptures and read the Scriptures to them and they would hear it. And what he says here is don't simply hear it. We could say in the modern day, don't simply read it and thus be deceived. That's interesting, isn't it? Now, we're aware that it's very easy to get deceived if you never read the Bible. If you never read the Bible, you will get deceived. You'll head off in all different kinds of directions. But what this text tells us is that you can actually read the Bible and still get deceived. That's concerning, isn't it? Don't merely read the word and so be deceived. Do what it says. Apply it. You've all heard the stories about the people who know the Bible inside out, but they abuse their kids. And you hear the story and you go, wait a minute, I thought that guy was a quote-unquote good Christian. He knows the Bible so well. And it really is a hard thing for us to get our arms around. Oh, we run into people who can parse Greek verbs, but they can't resolve conflict in their family. You know, they know the Bible, but or people that have memorized entire books of the Bible, but they cheat on their taxes. And there's this disconnect, and we can't figure out what it is. The reason there's a disconnect is because they've lived out the first part of this verse. They have heard the Bible, but they haven't applied it, and thus they're deceived. What is their deception? Their deception is that they're mature believers in Jesus Christ. They think they're mature simply because they know the Bible, but this passage tells us simply knowing the Bible doesn't make you mature. Maturity is found in actually living out what the Spirit has taught you in His Word. Do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. Howard Hendricks puts it this way. The Bible was not written to satisfy your curiosity. It was written to transform your life. The ultimate goal of Bible study, then, is not to do something to the Bible, but to allow the Bible to do something to you. The Holy Spirit wants to use the word of God to bring about life change. Look at verse 23. Anyone who listens to the word but does not do what it says is like a man who looks at his face in a mirror and after looking at himself goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. Does this sound strangely familiar to you? In other words, you look in the mirror and you think, wow, I need to wash my face and my hair has bedhead and it's just flying all over the place and I need to shave. I missed yesterday and now a second day I'm kind of looking like a mess and I need to take care of those rogue eyebrow hairs. And then you just walk away from the mirror and you don't do anything and you go off to work and you sit down at your desk or in your cubicle and your office mate comes in and the first thing they say to you is, dude, did you look in the mirror today? And if you say, well, yeah, I did, then they say, well, then what happened next? Because the assumption is if you look in the mirror and you see that, you're going to do something about it, right? It's silly to look in the mirror, see that, and walk away and not do something about it. Well, that's the analogy, that's the metaphor that he uses here. We can come and we can read the word and the Holy Spirit can lay something on our heart and then we can close our Bible, walk off and not let it impact us, and it's silly. We may as well not have looked in it in the first place. You know, mirrors are powerful things. The reason they're powerful is because they can't help but tell us the truth. Mirrors do not lie. You remember the Wicked Witch in Snow White? Mirror, mirror on the wall, who is the fairest of them all? And the mirror was very honest. You are, O Queen. Until Snow White came on the scene. Mirror, mirror on the wall, who is the fairest of them all? Then the mirror probably cleared his throat. Queen, you are the fairest where you are, but Snow White is more beautiful by far. Mirrors can't lie. You look in the mirror, you see what's true. That's why those really big magnifying mirrors are so terrifying, aren't they? Have you looked in one of those things recently? Ah! It is just telling you what's true. And the Bible is the ultimate mirror. Scripture is the ultimate mirror. It will tell you the truth about God and, my friends, the truth about you. So in verse 25, we get to the key verse in this whole passage. An amazing verse about applying God's word. But the man, the woman, the boy, the girl, who looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues to do this, not forgetting what he has heard, but doing it, he will be blessed in what he does. Let me pick this verse apart. First of all, he says, but the person who looks intently. Can you underline looks intently? Looks intently can be summarized by the two words observation and interpretation. Or, more specifically, by the six words, or the five words that we've already looked at in our series. Let me just remind you of them. Spirit. If you look intently into the word, what it means is you open the Bible and then you remember that the Holy Spirit wrote this thing and that this is actually a meeting with the author of the text. And so you pray, Holy Spirit, what do you want to say to me? What do you want to teach me? What do you want to show me about myself? I want this to be a mirror. I want to see the truth. Holy Spirit, use this time. I mean, it's a spiritual experience. Always is. If we surrender ourselves to Him and allow Him to make that happen. Okay? The second word that we looked at was story. Remember the outline? Kind of went something like this. We got the cross. Remember this? Those of you who were here that week, you know exactly what this is. You got creation and fall, and you got the nation of Israel, and then you got the civil war and the divided kingdom and the united kingdom and the rebuilding of the temple and the intertestamental period of 400 years, and then Jesus comes and the cross and the Holy Spirit comes and the church and then the church age, and then we're way out here. And you remember all that, and that's important because when you're reading the passage of Scripture, you've got to remember, where on this timeline is it? Was it before the cross? Was it after the cross? Was it before the Holy Spirit came or after the Holy Spirit came? Was it in the age of the law or in the age of grace? Is it in the future or is it in the present? These are really important questions, and this is what it means to look intently into God's Word. We spend a whole week on that, those of you that remember that. The next word was see. See. This is where I taught you how to read with your eyes, remember? And I told you to mark up the Bible. And so I gave you the color coding. So blue was all about God. Whenever you see God in there, you use blue with your colored pencils. And red was warnings, because that looks like a warning color, doesn't it? So whenever you see a warning in there, you put your red marker to use. And green was for blessings or promises. And then yellow, and I don't have a yellow marker up here. Yellow is for commands. And we read with our hands, right? And that's another way that we dive deeply, intently, looking into God's Word. And then we talked about surrounding, context, right? Surrounding. A text without a context is a pretext for a proof text. Remember, we have to see the whole story. And then we also talked about style, genre. That there's at least seven different types of books, each with their own interpretation rules, and you have to know what type of book you're reading. Okay, so all this stuff, all these S words, when you dive into God's Word and you spend time in it, you are intently looking into the Word of God. But if you just stop there, friends, you are in danger of being deceived. It can't just stop there. The verse doesn't stop there. The verse goes on to say this, but the man who looks, the woman who looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues to do this. Underline the word continues. Raise your hand if you're good. You're still writing with that hand, aren't you? Raise your other hand if you're good at starting things. Come on, raise your hand really high. And keep your hand up if you're really good at following through all the way to the end. Some of you are. Yeah, a lot of hands go down. I think it's kind of human nature. We're really good at starting things. It's really not easy to finish things. That's why we talk so often about finishing well. Because it's not something that we naturally do. Well, I think that's true of Bible reading, too. Over the entire time of this series, we've been giving you a chapter a day to read, and a lot of you have been reading that chapter every day. And some of you are a little nervous because that little bookmark's about to run out. And you're like, what do I do now? And that's appropriate if you're feeling nervous, but don't feel nervous. There's just a whole bunch of stuff to read in there. Just pick a book and start. Just read a chapter a day. You can keep doing this. I remember a number of years ago when I was having a hard time being consistent in keeping my physical exercise up. My wife Libby gave a great definition of consistency in exercise. Consistency in exercise is just starting over thousands of times. Starting over thousands of times. So you miss a day, you don't say, oh no, I blew it. Just start over. Start over the next day. You miss a week, you miss a month, whatever happens. Start over again and consistently go back to God's Word. It's part of diving in. It's part of looking intently into the perfect law. Can you imagine if we did a little experiment here at Bent Tree, and I'm talking on the physical realm here, and we said, okay, I need a specific group that wants to volunteer for an experiment. And what we're going to do with you is we're going to feed you once every week. here at the church on Sunday morning, we're going to put a big buffet table out. You can eat all you want, but you're not allowed to eat at all the rest of the week. I wonder how many of you would sign up for the experiment. Some of you would, because free food sounds great, right? Okay, but then the rest of you, and this has to be everyone else in the church, you only get to eat one meal a day, but 7 days a week. And you can eat at the buffet on Sunday too. About 6 months from now, how many in that first group do you think would be really robust and healthy? They'd be struggling, wouldn't they? And how many in that second group would actually be saying, you know what, one meal a day is just not quite enough. I need more than one meal a day. I hope the analogy is obvious. Eating God's word, feasting on God's word, is like food for your soul, food for your spirit. And what a lot of people think is, I'll go get my food at church on Sunday. I'll get my meal. I hope Pete's good today because I'm hungry. So it's kind of like my job to feed you, right? And then you go a whole week and you get here on Sunday morning, and you're like, oh, I'm starving for God's word again. You gorge yourself. You hope it lasts, right? This is not the way it's supposed to be. And those of you who spend a little time every day in God's word, here's what you're going to discover. Over time, you're going to say, one meal is not enough. And the more time you spend in God's word, the more desire you'll have for God's word, and the more hungry you'll be to spend time in the Bible. So he, by his spirit, will continue to encourage you to be consistent as he gives you that internal desire to spend time in his word. Okay, look at verse 25 again. But the woman who looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues to do this, not forgetting what he has heard, but doing it, he will be blessed in what he does. Underline not forgetting. Not forgetting. You see, you can look intently into God's word and you can do it consistently. You can still find yourself deceived. And so he continues to give us some ideas. And the next one is, don't forget what you've read. Don't forget what you've read. Here, I think, is where journaling comes in. Here's where journaling comes in. Because you can spend time in God's word, you can look intently, you can do all these things, and then you can get to the end of it, you can close the Bible, and off you go, and 2 weeks later, you can't remember anything you read. In fact, 2 days later, we can't remember anything we read. So what do? So at the end of your time in the word, just take out a little journal, and let me just say this before I start. No one's going to read it. You're not going to publish it. This is just for you and him. It's just a conversation between you and the Lord. And just start it, put a date on the top page, and just limit yourself to one page so that you don't feel the pressure to give this long volume. Just limit yourself to one page and say, here's what I learned in God's word today. Here's what I saw, observation. Here's what it means. And here's what God's laying on my heart to do about it. Just do that day in and day out, day in and day out. And guess what? Every once in a while, the Holy Spirit will lead you in your quiet time. And he'll just say, you know what, let's just go back and read a few of those pages that you've written in the past. And you go back a month and you just read 30 of these things, and you'd be amazed at the things that pop back into your mind, the things that you remember, the things that the Holy Spirit brings back to you. So journaling is not just a spiritual discipline that you do so you can check it off. It's a way to help you remember in the writing of it, that helps you remember, and then in the going back, that helps you to remember as well. Verse 25, but the man who looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues to do this, not forgetting what he has heard, you can do all that and still find yourself deceived. We need this last part. But doing it, he will be blessed in what he does. Doing it. Now, I want to remind you that we take every passage in context. And the book of James is taken in the context of the New Testament and in Scripture as a whole. The book of James was written after the cross, after the Holy Spirit came and filled the church. And so at the same time that Paul and Peter and John were writing all their letters, James wrote his as well. And so we have to take James in the context of everything else the New Testament writers wrote. And one of the things that I want to make sure you remember is that the New Testament writers are very, very clear on the fact that you don't do anything unless the Holy Spirit enables you to. Jesus taught this in John's gospel. He said, I am the vine, you are the branches. Rest in me, abide in me, and I will bear fruit through you. Apart from me, you can what? Do nothing. Apart from Christ, you can't do what James is encouraging you to do here. But in Christ, you obviously can. Paul talks about it all over the place. Galatians 2:20, For I was crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. And the life I now live, I live by faith. I live trusting in the one who loved me and gave himself for me. This is a faith walk, not a work walk. James even says it a little later in his letter in James chapter 4, verse 10. Humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will lift you up. Humble yourself before him, surrender to him, and he is the one who will do this in you. Peter, too, in 2 Peter 1, 3. I don't know if you've ever read this passage. It's stunning. His divine power has given us everything we need for life and godliness through our knowledge of him, because we know him, who called us by his own glory and goodness. Through these, he has given us his very great and precious promises, so that through them you may participate in the divine nature and escape the corruption in the world caused by evil desires. So in the Spirit, he has given us everything we need to live out what James encourages us to live out, as long as we're surrendering to the Spirit and allowing him to enable us to do it. So don't turn James into a legalistic thing. I've got to do everything it says. James is, in concert with the rest of the New Testament writers, reminding us that the Holy Spirit will enable us to live this way. That being said, how does this doing it work? Well, I'm glad you asked that question, because there's three questions I want you to write down in your notes. Okay, some of the other sermons in this series, I give you way too much to write down. Just three things to write down today. When you are asking the application questions, there are three of them I would like you to ask. The first one is, how does God want me to think differently? How does God want me to think differently? The second question is, how does God want me to feel differently? How does God want me to feel differently? And the third question is, what does God want me to do differently? What does God want me to do differently? You say, Pete, that is so simplistic. Really? Well, it's not that simplistic. Those three questions actually give you an incredible parameter for application. Let me show you what I mean. This is a diagram you've seen before, but I want to show it to you again and apply it specifically to what we're looking at here. This is our spiritual anatomy. Spirit, soul, and body. This is who you are as a person, right? And remember, those of us who are in Christ, he comes and gives us a new heart, a new spirit. We're a new creation. And Christ, by the Holy Spirit comes to indwell us. And this is what we call experiencing life. We are experiencing the life of Christ. And the Christian life is really all about Christ expressing his life in us and through us. Okay, this is language you're all familiar with if you're a part of Bent Tree. But then remember, our soul is comprised of mind, will, and emotions. This is kind of our personality, right? All those things were inactive before we met Christ, when we were still dead in our spirit. But now that Christ is living in us, he wants to impact these things. Our mind is our thinker, our will is our chooser, and our emotions is our feeler, okay? So what we're asking three questions. Holy Spirit, as you speak to me and minister to me while I'm in the Word, what do you want me in my mind to think differently? What do you want me in my emotions to feel differently? And what choices do you want me to make so I do things differently? But we can take this diagram out even a little bit farther, can't we? The next circle are three kind of categories of how this looks in discipleship. Life in Christ talks about our personal walk with him. Life with others. And then life expressed. The fact that Jesus wants to express his life through us. And so in our personal world, yeah, here we go, we're still going. Spiritual growth is what Jesus is doing in each of us individually. Community is life with others within the context of the church, right? And service is what Christ wants to do through us to our brothers and sisters around us. And then one more circle, There's a reason I'm going over this all again with you. I want you to see it, okay? Life in Christ expressed outside our personal walk. We call this worship, a life of worship. Scotty was talking about this today during our musical worship time. Life with others outside the church is called evangelism. And life expressed outside the church is called missions. Justice, compassion, all those kinds of things. Okay, so if you just ask these three questions, you find yourself opening up a whole bevy of opportunities for application. So I'm reading a passage, and the question I'm asking is, what do you want me to think differently about? And it's a passage about mission. It's a passion about the poor. What do you want me to think differently about the poor? And then you hear something about sex trafficking. And you say, all right, Lord, what do you want me to feel differently about sex trafficking? So I'm not just thinking about it, but I'm also feeling it. How do you want me to feel? God, how do you feel? Holy Spirit, how do you feel when you hear about this, when you see this going on? I want to feel that too. Are there any decisions in my life that you want me to make because I've learned about sex trafficking? Okay, that's just one example, okay? Maybe there's someone in our neighborhood that we know doesn't know Jesus, and we're reading in the Gospels, and we're reading about God's heart, Christ's heart for the lost. We're reading the Zacchaeus story, maybe. And as we're reading that, we're asking the question, how do you want me to think differently about this? And as I'm praying that, the Holy Spirit brings that person to mind. I want you to think that this person is lost, the Holy Spirit says. I haven't thought about that person being lost forever. What do you want me to feel as I'm reading the Zacchaeus story about my friend who's lost? I want you to feel the weight of his lostness. Okay, Holy Spirit, I can't muster that up. You got to do that in me. You see the interaction you're having with the author as you're reading the text? Lord, is there anything you want me to do? Yeah, I'd like you to chat with him about me. Oh, no, really? I need to journal this. I need to journal about all the things he's telling me. You see how this works? And so now you've got all these opportunities. If you're thinking this when you're reading the text and you're asking the question, what do you want me to think differently? What do you want me to feel differently? What do you want me to do differently? Then God has an opportunity to really lay things on your heart. Let's try it. Can we try it? Go ahead and throw that slide up just so in case they can't read my scratchings, my chicken scratchings. That's our little experience life diagram, and it's also a great application diagram as well. Look back at James chapter 1, verse 2. James chapter 1, verse 2. Let's pretend that you just sat down for your quiet time and you're just reading through the New Testament and you're in James chapter 1. And so you read the introduction to James chapter 1 and verse 1 and you get to verse 2. And I want you to tell me, do you think this is a think differently, feel differently, or do differently passage? Okay? Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds. Think, feel, or do differently. What do you think? Yeah, we had kind of mixed results. Is the word consider a thinking word or a feeling word? Probably a thinking word. He wants us to think about trials differently than we've thought about them in the past. What does he want us to think? He wants us to think that trials are pure joy. That's not how we tend to think about trials. Okay, so the mirror is looking at us and saying, you know, when you, Pete, think about trials, you tend to think that they're pure hell. I want you to think differently. I want you to consider them to be pure joy. You say, all right, I'm open to that, Lord, but why in the world would I consider something that really hurts to be joyful? I'm going to keep reading. He's going to tell me why. Because you know that the testing of your faith develops perseverance. Perseverance must finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. Oh, James provides the reason for us. The reason that he wants us to consider trials to be pure joy is because my response to my trial will determine whether I grow in it or not. So the way I respond to this will determine whether I actually get something out of my trial or not. It's possible to have a trial and not grow at all through it. How does that happen? It happens if we don't consider it pure joy. Okay, so here's where the Holy Spirit comes in. We're like, all right, Lord, I get it. That makes sense. I can't muster joy up in this trial. I can't do this. She says, of course you can't. It's my job. Your job is to surrender to the work of the Spirit and ask me to do it in you. Holy Spirit, give me joy in the midst of this trial so that I can grow. You see how God's Word, when we're asking the right questions, can give us specific things to be praying about and to be looking for. Let's keep reading in the text. Verse 5, if any of you lacks wisdom, he should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to him. Think differently, do differently, or feel differently. What do you think? Do differently. Thank you. This is a do differently thing. The Holy Spirit says, I know how you need wisdom. I know how you've been trying to gain wisdom. I want you to do it a little differently. Here's how I want you to do it. I want you to ask me for it. I want you to ask. And the God who gives generously to all without finding fault will give it to you as well. And so we're in our quiet time. And before we started our quiet time, we had a lot on our mind, a lot of stuff we were struggling with. So we read this passage. We're like, you know, I need wisdom because there's stuff that I don't know how to handle in my life. There's stuff going on in my life, I just don't get how to do it. I've got decisions I need to make. I don't know what to do. I need wisdom. And I've tried to ask this person, they weren't helpful. I've tried to read this book, that didn't help. I'm out of ideas. I'm out of ideas on what to do with this coworker who's undermining me, or this spouse who's threatening to leave me, or this bill, I can't pay it. I'm out of money. No more money. I've got this bill. What do you do when you have a bill and you don't have any more money? I don't know what to do. I need wisdom. I need wisdom because my teenager has stopped listening to me. I need wisdom because my job search is stretching out month after month after month. How do you find a job in this environment? I don't know. I've tried everything. I've talked to all my contacts. I don't know. I'm at a loss. I don't know how to deal with this temptation. I don't know how to overcome this addiction. I'm struggling with whether to do this ministry opportunity or not. I don't know what to do with my lotto winnings. Anyone struggling to know what to do with your lotto winnings? Because I can help you with that. We got a building fund. We'd love to point you that direction. I've tried to think of something. I'm simply stumped. And then we read this text, and it's like, oh, he wants me to do something differently. Instead of asking everyone else, I'm supposed to ask him. In obedience, Lord God, to your word, I come now. And you have told me in your word that you're full of wisdom. You are perfectly wise, Jesus, and you live in me. I want to tap into your wisdom. Jesus, fill me with your wisdom. I'm available. Show me. Show me what to do. And then you open your eyes and you look for the answer, because in the text he promised to give you the wisdom. It's available to you. You look for it. What forms is it going to come in? You know, it might be you just continue reading in the text and all of a sudden, poof, comes right out at you. Sometimes the Holy Spirit might just lay it on your heart. He might just whisper and reveal something to your heart. Hear me? If it is contrary to Scripture, it's not the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will only reveal something to you that's commensurate with what's in God's word. Sometimes it will be in the context of community. You'll be in your small group and someone will say something and you'll go, that's what I've been, thank you. And you'll give him the glory because he gave it to you. You just had eyes to see it. What does he want me to do differently? He wants me to look for him to be my wisdom instead of everything else. Look at verse 9, one more before we're done. The brother in humble circumstances, okay, so someone who's poor, ought to take pride in his high position. Think differently, do think differently, or feel differently. I think this is a feel differently one. He's talking to the poor person who walks into the room that's full of high-powered business people and high rollers. How does that person feel? That person feels, I don't belong here. Why am I here? I want to just disappear. Can I get out of here? That person feels inferior. And what he says is, I want you to feel differently. You poor people, I want you to feel differently than that. The Bible is consistent. It teaches us that poor people, materially poor people, are generally more prone to surrender to the Spirit, more receptive to the gospel, more ready to walk away from all their stuff because they got so little to lose. The general teaching of Scripture is that poor people tend to get the Jesus thing, rich people struggle with it. James knows that. So he says, when you walk into a room, I don't want you thinking about how you don't fit there. I want you thinking about the incredible advantage you have over all these poor rich people. I I want you to start feeling as though you're the privileged one in the room. What a different thought. What a different feeling. But he's not done yet. Verse 10. But the one who is rich should take pride in his low position. Those of us who are rich should feel differently too. We should feel differently. You say, Pete, I'm not rich. Can I just point out to you that in entire human history, people who live in the United States, all the people who live in the United States find themselves in the top 2% of the wealthiest people who have ever lived on the planet Earth. So in a text like this, we're the rich people. And what he's saying to us is, I want you to feel differently too. I want you to take pride in your low position. He's recalibrating the position that we think we have. What position do we feel we have? Well, we normally feel secure because we've got money. We feel provided for. We feel immune to the bad things. We might even start to feel immortal because, you know, if something comes along, I've got the money, I'll take care of it. There's medical and stuff, I can pay for it. I don't know if I'm ever going to die. We start thinking this way. I don't know if you heard about Allen Iverson, the former NBA player who got pulled over recently in his Lamborghini, and he was kind of giving the police officer a hard time. The police officer said, I might just impound your car. His response, go ahead, take the car. I got 12 more just like it at home. La-di-da. He feels invincible. You can't touch me. I got other Lamborghinis. Take it. Okay, before we're too hard on poor old Alan, we have the same, very similar kind of attitude. You can't touch me. I got a bank account. Don't worry about it. We'll be fine. And we trust in what we have. We trust in our wealth. And James says, I need you feeling differently than that. I need you recognizing what an incredible disadvantage you're in. Because you're not invincible. That's what he says. Because he, the rich guy, will pass away like a wild flower. The sun rises with scorching heat and withers the plant. Its blossom falls and its beauty is destroyed. In the same way, the rich man will fade away even when he goes about his business. It'll happen in a moment, and all of a sudden you'll realize, whoa, I'm not as invincible as I thought. In the same way that there's an advantage to being poor because you're receptive to the Spirit's work, my friends, there is a disadvantage to being rich. Because self-sufficiency is the exact opposite of surrender. He wants us to feel differently about where we are. So we get done with that text and we're like, you know, Holy Spirit, I know I'm supposed to feel that I'm not secure in the money that I've put away. I can't do that. I honestly feel pretty secure. So Holy Spirit, I'm available to you. Chip away at my security. I want my security to be only in you. I am available for this work to be done in me by you. See how these three little questions just open up all these places for the Holy Spirit to work. Look at verse 25. But the man who looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues to do this, not forgetting what he has heard, but doing it, he, she will be, circle it, blessed in what he reads. Is that what it says? No. It doesn't say blessed in what he reads. He will be blessed in what he memorizes. He will be blessed in what he studies. He will be blessed in what he can read in Greek. Please hear me. He will be blessed in what he does. Note, the blessing is not in the reading, in the study, in the memorization. The blessing is in the application. Simply reading the text can potentially lead to deception. Reading plus application leads to blessing. Here's what this means. Let me say it this way. In my introduction sermon, I quoted Howard Hendricks. He said there's three kinds of Bible readers. Remember that? The nasty medicine types? Who say, you know, this Bible tastes bitter, but it's good for me, so I'll take it. And then there's the shredded wheat type. The Bible is nourishing, but it's dry. It's kind of like eating I couldn't figure out how to say that. I'm getting a little tired, I think. It's like eating hay. It's dry, but it's good for me. And then there's the strawberries and cream people, right? The people who just can't get enough. They have an insatiable appetite. And I know some of you sat there like, I want that, I want that. Here's the secret. You want to hear the secret? The secret is in this entire passage, verse 25. Diving in, observation, interpretation. Consistently diving in, observation, and interpretation. Not forgetting what we've learned in the power of the Spirit, stepping into what the Spirit is prompting us and experiencing life change. And guess what will happen? You'll experience that life change and you'll say, this is blessing. What a blessing I've just experienced. This is better. Living like this is better than the way I used to live. Where's my Bible? I want to see the next thing he wants to do in my life. And all of a sudden you have this insatiable desire to be blessed again as the Holy Spirit enables you to walk in newness of life. Does that make sense? Does that make sense? Yes? Whew. All right, good. Let me pray for you. Please stand. I want to pray for you standing up. Heavenly Father, thank you for this really practical passage. James is a very practical writer. Thank you for teaching us that we can be deceived into thinking we're spiritually mature just because we study a lot. And we can wonder why we're not experiencing blessing in our life, even though we're reading the Bible, and we just realized that the blessing is found when the Holy Spirit actually brings about change in our life because we've surrendered to him. So, Lord, my prayer for my people is that they would experience that blessing, that even this week as they dive into your word, that they would see what's there and they would understand what it means. And they would ask, you want me to think, feel, or do differently? And you would lay by your Spirit something on their heart, and then they would write it down in their journal. And then by your Spirit, you would give them opportunities to step into obedience. And in that moment, they'd say yes. And you, by your Spirit, would use your word to transform our relationships, our behavior, the stuff about us that you want to bring change to. So I just pray this for my people. And I pray it in Jesus' precious name.